1951 was the year of the Festival of Britain. Coming up from Cornwall to see the Skylon and the Dome of Discovery and the room-sized computer that would play a simple variant of Noughts and Crosses gave me my first real experience of London. I remember I was more impressed by the number of statues than anything else, and now realise that we do go in for such monumental memorial street furniture far more than most people. It was a hot summer. I sweltered along the tarmac and among the crowds with the family friend who had brought me, and she took good care not to lose me, generously stopping whenever the thirsty little boy at her hand needed more orange juice or cups of tea to irrigate a metabolism overprotected by grey flannel school uniform. But hot summers can also lead to an upsurge in peculiarly distressing types of crime, as some children run out to play unsupervised and sick predators may loaf around their vicinity. John Straffan was a 21-year-old labourer from Bath. He had several convictions for housebreaking and petty theft, one for child molesting. He had twice been declared mentally deficient and sent for treatment, twice released to fend for himself, a policy now dignified with the name community care, which is cheaper than institutionalisation and infinitely preferable for those who actually can cope in a sympathetic community. But one, as Straffan made tragically clear, which demands quite extraordinary alertness, perceptiveness, caution and sympathy on the part of those responsible for administering it. On Sunday the 8th of July, 7-year-old Christine Butcher went missing in Windsor. She'd gone out during the afternoon to join crowds watching the King and Queen as they went to open a new recreation centre at the village in Windsor Great Park. She was seen in the middle of the afternoon near the Star and Garter Hotel, seen again in an alley near a hotel car park, and then not seen again. By Tuesday, troops had been called in to help with the search for the missing child, and on Tuesday evening her body was found in Stephen's Meadow in Windsor Park. She had been sexually assaulted and suffocated. Police hopes that a home movie made of the Royal Progress would lead to a speedy arrest and conviction were sharply dashed. For although Christine could be clearly identified in the alley near the car park, not only the four people caught in the same place by the camera, but also a fifth who had been out of frame, came forward and public-spiritedly gave perfectly good accounts of themselves. The following Sunday, another little girl was found strangled. Brenda Goddard's body was found in a copse near Bath, 3 hours after she'd left her home to go out and play. The public feared that a maniac was roving the counties to the southwest of London. But the police instantly exchanged details of the two murders and concluded that they were not by the same hand. Christine had been suffocated. Brenda had been strangled. Christine had been sexually assaulted. Brenda had not. Thereafter, Somerset Police and Thames Valley Police kept each other informed, but it was clear to them that at no time were the two in pursuit of the same man. And, lamentably, Christine Butcher's killer has never been caught. On August the 8th, however, Brenda's murderer struck again. Cicely Bathstone's body was found in a field near Bath. This time, there was evidence that she had been in the company of a young man. They had been seen at the pictures in Bath, but whether at a cinema showing a Tarzan film or another showing a Western seemed uncertain. Fortunately, the young man was quickly identified as John Straffan, who lived at a cottage not far from the point where Cicely's body was found. Straffan's responses to questioning were what one might have expected of a guilty mental defective. He told some lies, though they didn't in any way help to exonerate him. He told bits of the truth, and they only served to satisfy police that he was the murderer. He said he had gone to the Tarzan film, and Cicely came in and sat near him. It seems likely enough that he went in on his own. A 21-year-old going specially to see Tarzan would most likely be either very intelligent and going for a laugh, or remarkably unintelligent, as Straffan was. We may doubt, however, whether Cicely joined him without any encouragement. He claimed that after the Tarzan film was over, Cicely asked him to take her on to the Western, and he agreed. It's possible. Then his statement became silly. He admitted walking back with her beside the meadow where her body was found. He said they separated there because he wanted to go home and she wanted to go into the meadow. He said that they went into the meadow together, and she said she was tired and lay down to go to sleep, whereupon he left her and went home. He said there was a courting couple in the meadow when he went there, and he and Cicely both lay down to rest. Then he got up and went away, leaving her with the courting couple, who must have killed her. He said that he knew she was dead before he left. With a set of self-contradictory statements like that, the police did not need a formal confession. Strafford was charged with the murders on August the 24th and remanded in custody for examination. Perhaps the most important doctor to examine him was Dr. Leach, who had seen him in 1947 on one of the occasions when Strafford was found to be mentally defective. Strafford told Leach that he had killed Cicely Barthstone, offering the extraordinary reason that it would annoy the police. It seemed to him a sensible thing to do, as it was safer than stealing. Now, making every allowance for Strafford's mental deficiencies, which are surely to heaven apparent enough in his making such a statement at all, it still seems to me surprising that a number of commentators have accepted this as his genuine motive, with the implication that he was a unique murderer of little girls who was not really sexually interested in them. The fact that he exclusively killed girls rather than boys argues against this conclusion prima facie. So, more importantly, does his prior conviction for sexually assaulting a child. Strafford was, in my view, a pederast who came to enjoy his maximum satisfaction when he strangled his victims. Still, his mental deficiency remained. As early as the pretty brutal 18th century, we realized that it is not compatible with civilization and humanity to go around hanging people who are too deluded to know what they've done or too feeble-witted to understand the process by which they're being tried for their crimes and under which they will have to attempt to establish their innocence. Strafford escaped the noose under this latter consideration. By the McNaughton rules governing lunatics' criminal responsibility, which obtained at the time, he was, I think, clearly liable to pay the penalty. He knew that what he was doing was wrong, even in the unlikely event that his intention was only to get his own back on the police for his former arrests in a way that would be safer than theft. But he would never have had the intelligence to understand the nature of an assize court and the men in wigs orating for and against him. In October, he was declared unfit to plead and sent to Broadmoor. And there his story should have ended, sordid and tragic in its different ways, but essentially unimportant, and lacking the great qualities of passion or mystery or calculating evil that mark the classic murder. But at 2:30 on Tuesday, April the 29th, 1952, Strafford was mopping out a corridor in Broadmoor when he asked the attendant for permission to go out and relieve himself. Given permission, he slipped out, found nobody in sight, and slipped over the wall. 4 hours later, he was retaken a considerable distance away after he had aroused suspicion by going in to ask where he was at a tea house. About an hour after Strafford had been reincarcerated, 5-year-old Linda Bowyer's body was found in a lane near to the place where he had been taken. Knowing what the name Strafford means to us today, it is quite extraordinary to look at a newspaper for Wednesday, April the 30th, and see 2 short adjacent items reporting that an inmate named John Strafford had escaped from Broadmoor the previous day and wandered around Berkshire for 4 hours during the afternoon before being retaken, and, as a completely unconnected incident, that a little girl had been found strangled in a lane in Berkshire that evening. The 2 incidents were, of course, rapidly connected. Witnesses were found who had seen Strafford coax the little girl away from a group of children near an ice cream van and go with her in the direction of the lane. And Strafford was again charged with murder. But how could he be if he was unfit to plead? This case has led to occasional confusion among crime historians and criminologists over the exact status of criminal lunatics. Paul Begg and N.P. Warren used to argue with me that the man the police committed to Coney Hatch Asylum in December 1888 could not, as I maintained, be Jack the Ripper, because there was no reason why they should not have charged him once they had established his identity with the murderer. It had, Paul claimed, been done in other cases. When I learned that other cases actually meant Strafford, I was able to correct him. Strafford's was a quite extraordinary case, and the fact that he was charged at all was profoundly controversial. Under normal circumstances, as everybody, including the prosecution, recognised, a lunatic who escaped from Broadmoor would not and could not be charged with any crime whatsoever. The courts would recognise that he was inevitably not guilty by reason of insanity, as that verdict used to stand before moralistic old Queen Victoria demanded that it must be renamed guilty but insane. If Strafford had been certified insane, no one would ever imagine they could put him on trial, heinous though his offence had been. But Strafford was not certifiably insane. He was mentally defective. No mental illness clouded his simple ability to know the difference between manifest right and manifest wrong. No hallucinations or delusions led him to believe it was actually a virtuous thing to kill little girls. He did it with a vicious intent, even by his own account. He had escaped the rope because he was too hopelessly congenitally stupid to understand legal proceedings. He was unfit to plead because he was incapable of understanding what defending himself in court amounted to, not because he had no idea of the moral import of his actions. His case has no bearing whatever on the head of CID's claim that he had Jack the Ripper identified, but unfortunately after he had already been certified insane. Still, how could Strafford be brought to trial if he couldn't understand the proceedings? Well, here we come up against the usual problem of expert testimony. Psychologists were found to say that Strafford's 6 months in Broadmoor had proved very therapeutic, that he had improved considerably since his incarceration in October, that he was still stupid beyond the normal limitations of that word, but no longer incapable of understanding the proceedings. A pretty unlikely claim, I should have thought. The enormous problem with all psychological evidence in cases where a sufficiently abnormal state exists for murder to have occurred must be that the psychologist is incapable of avoiding his own bias toward or against retributive justice, especially if, as in Strafford's case, it entails capital punishment. The murder of any little girl, under any circumstance, is perfectly horrible, and will arouse in any right-minded and healthy person intense feelings of rage and frustration. They are so strong that whether you think it right or wrong to alleviate those feelings by killing the murderer is likely to take unconscious priority over your purely clinical assessment of his fitness to plead. At any rate, it is unusual to find a murder case where experts cannot be found for both sides to declare quite positively that the defendant is or is not insane. So, now, the defence furiously challenged the proceedings on the ground that Strafford had already been found unfit to plead, and the prosecution could not have another bite at the cherry because the authorities had been so incompetent as to let an incarcerated man escape and repeat the evil action for which he'd been rightly locked up. Dr. Leach was brought out to repeat his observations on Strafford over the years, but the court allowed the proceedings to go forward. Judges probably always have a mild bias in favour of letting cases be tested by formal trial. So a different line of defence had to be produced to establish Strafford's claim of innocence. Two witnesses came forward who had heard a little girl's screams from the lane where Linda was found. Only this screaming occurred at 7 p.m. half an hour after Strafford was safely back in the hands of the men in white coats. Now, what did these witnesses really hear? Was it an early screech owl? Unlikely, since if you ever lived near families of them, you wouldn't be likely to mistake them for children. Or did they get the time wrong? Or did some other children scream in their play? For they don't convince me, as I don't believe they convinced Strafford's counsel, and they certainly didn't convince the jury, that someone else had murdered Linda Bowyer after Strafford was arrested. Strafford was convicted and sentenced to death, and reprieved by the Home Secretary. And so began the public uproar which would make him memorable. Would it have been right to hang this half-wit, horrible though his actions might be? Shouldn't execution always make the world safer for children whenever pederastic murderers are caught, whatever the extenuating circumstances? Why should a vicious killer escape due process of law twice on a legal technicality? How outrageous that a killer should escape to kill again. Whenever you hear the argument about killers killing again, it's likely that someone has Strafford in the back of his mind. Yet, the argument over Strafford is misplaced. It was never Strafford's head that should have rolled at all. Going back to the old newspapers covering the affair, the most shocking observation to my mind was that made by the staff of Broadmoor. They were not surprised. They had been complaining for years that the hospital was hopelessly insecure, given the dangerous calibre of patient for whom they were responsible. But the Home Office hadn't listened. Public money couldn't be found. Criminal nutters weren't a high priority. So it is we, my friends, you and I, whenever we begrudge public money for proper, safe and humane custodial care of dangerous criminals, who play the wickedest role in murders like those of Brenda Goddard and Cicely Bathstone and Linda Bowyers, and the murders of those always at risk prison and criminal asylum attendants who look after the moral detritus of our society for us. Ask not for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for us.